call this committee meeting of the Crestwood School Board order. Please rise for pledge allegiance. I pledge allegiance to the flag of the United States of America and to the republic for which it stands, one nation, under God, indivisible, with liberty and justice for all. Roll call.
Mrs. Haddock? Mr. Nardone?
Here.
Mrs. Campbell?
Here.
Mrs. McCurdy? Mr. Brogna? Mr. Schwank? Mrs. Bibla? Mr. Boone?
Here.
Mr. McCray?
Here.
Just waiting for Stacy.
Academic programs, Mr. Boone?
Mrs. Campbell and I are present. I make a motion to programs committee meeting.
Second.
All in favor?
Aye.
Aye. We'll be seeking approval of items 1 through 3 to move to the agenda next week for the board meeting. Questions or discussion from board members? Or the public? If not, I'll make a motion to move items 1, 2, and 3 to next week's board meeting.
Second.
All in favor?
Aye.
Aye. We have some open discussion. We have some pretty good news from our superintendent on 2 items there.
Thank you. So, good evening, everyone. I actually have 2 presentations to provide to all of you today. The first one that we have that I'm going over is our AP or Advanced Placement Review from our 22-23 school year. So before we get into that,
that should be it. Now you can do it with the cursor on the keyboard. The arrow buttons.
Okay, so before we go into advanced placement at Crestwood, I just thought I'd have a fun fact, a little bit about Crestwood's history. So I'm just asking here, if anyone wants to answer it, you can, or if you know. Okay, so how long has Crestwood offered students advanced placement courses?
Since 1987.
Well, I'm not going to challenge you on that, but you're very close.
I taught the first AP course for the first year. And
nice.
I think we graduated the kids. Well, we started in 86.
Oh, all right.
We started in 86.
Late, graduated in 87.
So it's 37 years.
Right.
So it started in 1986. That is correct. So what are the benefits of advanced placement courses? It's an opportunity for students to take college-level classes at the secondary campus. They are taught by our Crestwood teachers. And currently, you know, our 22-23 school year, we had 10th graders, 11th graders, and 12th graders participate in our AP courses. Students are challenged through a rigorous course that prepares them for their future post-secondary educational goals. So it helps them develop their skills and their concepts that will transcend into college to build a successful foundation. And students are better prepared for college success. So again, more benefits of it. Why am I having a hard time today? Benefits of advanced placements course. So students can achieve college credit or advanced placement in their desired college or university. An advanced standing with a score of 3 or higher. And I put on here, and all this information will be on our website where it says AP credit search. That actually takes you a link to an area that will show you what AP requirements that each college and university require. So if you have a 3 or higher, doesn't mean that college or university that your student is interested in. So that will actually provide you, because maybe, for example, if you took one of our AP courses, say for Wilkes, they'll accept a 3. If you go to, say, Villanova, they may require a 4 or 5. So that link will be there for families and anybody that wants to research. So Crestwood offerings. So what offerings do we have? Currently, we have 8 AP course offerings. There's the list there. I won't read them all to you. But that's what we had for our 22-23 school year. Some may ask, well, how many do, you know, our surrounding school districts have? So I reached out to the IU 18 superintendents and asked them, you know, where do you guys stand with your AP offerings? We were right about 8 is about the average, but one of the schools did have 11. So, but some of those classes were identical to what we had. They had like an art theory, I saw psychology, biology, but pretty much most of them had 8 to 9 of them. So we're right in the middle of the pack. So what is an advanced AP exam? So it's a standardized college board exam that's designed to measure the student's understanding of that content and their skill level in that specific course. Exams are administered every year in May. Everyone takes them at the same time. They're about a 4 to 4.5 hour exam. And these results that I will be sharing with you were done in July. We didn't have a committee meeting, so I just wanted to present it in August, but the students, the district found out on July 5th, and that's traditionally around this time. The grading scale is a 5-point scale, 1 to 5. 3 is the minimum bar for colleges, and I already briefly went over that the differences that some of the universities may have and their requirements to accept them, it could be a 4 to 5, usually provides the advantage in college acceptance. Okay, so specific to Crestwood, student participation increased from the prior year by 16%. So that means we had, I believe, over 137 in 21-22. So in 22-23, we were up 16%, which is a great achievement that we had. Student participation rate was 83% of the roster versus exam. So here you'll see our student rosters of the students that took the test. And this shows you the exams. So for instance, right here, United States history, 22 students actually took the class, but 20 of them decided to take the exam. Not all of our students do take the exam. It's not a requirement, but that is what we had this year. So some of the highlights, for instance, calculus, you'll see student rosters 38, 37, but down in French, you saw there were 6 that were rostered, only 1 took the exam. That is a choice of the student and their family.
Do you have to take the course to sit for the exam?
No, you do not. So if you are, you do not have to.
It's advised 1 year. I taught the regular calculus. We had 9 students take the calculus test. None of them got 3 or higher. So when you're teaching an AP course, it's a much more rigorous background. And prior to having these exams, I know every year, I remember Mrs. Madden, would have 1 or 2 students take the calculus AP test, and but it was your 1 or 2 top ones. So you do not have to, but it's strongly recommended.
It's part of the curriculum too. They have pre-tests and things to help prepare you for those. But yes, to answer your question.
It's just because on your English Lit it had 23 rostered, but 24 exams.
Yeah, I checked that twice because yeah, I did know. I was like, hey, is that right? But yeah, so we did have 1 student. So some other highlights, Crestwood students scored in 5 out of the 8 content areas they actually met or exceeded the state and the global. So the courses that were taken, the 5 content areas, English literature, environmental science, French language and culture, physics 1, and United States history. So we set above the state and globally. And again, I know there's a lot of information on here, but so you can see here, I'm just gonna pick physics. 1. So these are in red. So our mean score was 2.92. The mean state score was 2.58. And the global score was 2.55. So there, and all the ones in red show the 5 areas that we were higher. Very close in calculus AB. If you look at the first one, our mean score was 2.97. It was lower than the state for sure, but close to the global. So you know, French here, 4.0, state mean, 3.11, 3.20. That was the 1 student that took that exam. Physics 2, you can see here, mean score 2.74. The state was 3.09, and global was actually higher than the state. So you'll see sometimes that the state are higher than the global averages. So future objectives on AP and support academic services. So this is my last slide that I have. So looking into this school year to prepare for the next school year, we're going to continue those 8 AP courses in 23-24. But I'd also like to look at additional course offerings for 24 and 25. You know, looking at other school districts, what are they taking? But most importantly, our students. We want to hear from our students, like, what are you hearing? What do you think we should offer? So we're going to be taking a look at our class offerings, talk to our staff as well, besides our students. And guidance. Guidance is a big key to the advanced placement, understanding what you just said, Mr. Boone, what it takes to be in an AP course. So guidance is an important part. Our staff is an important part of this process. So they're going to have discussions with our 9th and 10th graders to talk about AP. Is that something that they want for their future? And then I'm going to turn it over to Mr. Gorham to talk about the reorganization of our guidance department at the secondary campus. Great. Before I do that, I'll ask if you guys have any questions on AP. Go ahead.
So if you look at our scores from this past year and other years, do we get detailed, like, school content to say, is there a particular area that we need to focus on, that we're not focusing on, that would get our scores higher? Do they come out with it, or do they just say, here's your student score, or do they break down by sections the score for review for at a teacher level or a school level?
I don't know what they do now. In the past, all I received was the overall scores. They didn't go.
So there's not like one section, like integrals or something that would say, hey, I need to spend more time on this to get that section up.
The information that I have is the highest level of information that I am aware of that I can get. I have it broken down by the grade, the student. I can tell you what the student was, how they matched each level, but I'm not aware of that specific category.
So we don't get a breakdown to say, to just, like, if we were to adjust environmental science or Spanish, well, we want to spend more time in this part of the classwork to improve the chances of a 3 or higher.
And I think that would be pretty difficult. I know in the calculus side, there's open-ended sections, mm-hmm. and an open-ended question would have 3 or 4 parts, and it would cover 3 or 4 different areas. Mm-hmm. So that would be extremely time-consuming and, I think, difficult to get that information
to dissect
from
that out of there. Yeah.
It would be nice, though, if they gave you at least to say they struggled more on the open-ended, or they struggled, do you know what I'm
yeah.
saying? It would be nice if they gave you at least that,
like,
or they struggled more on the essays, or they struggled more multiple choice. At least it would be nice if they gave that. I mean,
and that's
through
the college board, like our
right,
BSSAs
right,
do that,
right,
what you're talking about,
right,
but the
yeah.
college board, not the lawyer.
Yeah.
I know it's not an apples-to-apples comparison because the students change every year, but with COVID in the rearview mirror, do you know if these scores are trending higher?
I have some of that information that I can give to you. Let's see if I brought it with me. If I don't have it with me, I can.
I know we can get it. Last year when I asked for the scores, they gave us like the last 5 years. So we can.
Yes, I
we
have.
Can, we can look at that.
So for instance, I build spreadsheets. So, for instance, pick one that you like. How about that? Instead of me,
calculus. I was always a math
guy. Okay, so calculus. Last, so 21-22 school year. I'll be able to break it down this way. How's that? So, if they scored a 1, okay, and I'll go through each number. Does that make sense? Okay. So, last year's total exam was in 21-22 was 24, and I said it went up, it was 37, okay? So that's the participation. Those who scored a 1 in 22, I'll just end it with that, the 22 was 5. In 23, it was 4. So that's good, okay? So then it scored a 2, there was 3, but this year there was 11.
But there were more people taking it.
Correct. So then in a 3, there was 4 that had a 3. Now we had 9 that had the 3, which is like your minimum. Then in your 4, they had a 5. Now they had an 8. And then in a 5, they had 7. Now they're a 5. So it's hard because of the total amount of it as well, and the students
yeah.
are changing. But you can see from a 3 up, it's to our favorable, which is what we're looking for.
And I
have that all broken down, so when I upload this, I'll upload this too, so you have it, so you can look at it more granularly that way.
And that's hard, like you said, that's not apples to apples. When we started out, we had a five-year run where we had 100% of the kids pass the CalKP test. We only had maybe 15 kids a year take it. And okay, so you're talking your top 15. Now when you get into your top 30, some of those
back end gets watered down.
Gets watered down a little bit. So I think it's very hard to make that comparison.
Your assumption is your assumption is your top 15 are taking it. You're not sure if it's about the top 15. Well, you have 30 kids in a classroom.
My top 15 in my CalKP class, yes.
Again, some will take it, some will not.
So we worked on and
usually it is.
Yeah. And we worked on, my last year we were up to 31 and all passed.
Is there any other questions with AP?
I would just like to say, I appreciate that you're looking into other AP classes for the future. And I agree, definitely, I think guidance should be involved, the kids' interest should be involved. I would like to see, though, if there is an interest in maybe something that would help the kids going into the medical field. You know, just looking, we have certain AP classes that could be gone into certain careers. Not really any up there would help someone wanting to go into pre-med, nursing, the therapies, PA. You know what I mean? So maybe like an AP anatomy or an AP bio or chem, like something
bio
like
is
that.
Like one of our, Mr. Warm has already started to look into bio.
Okay.
We've been talking about the bio.
Just something for those kids to boost their applications to college if they have those on that.
Any other questions? So again, so this is the last part about the guidance. So there is a reorganization, again, with the reduction of staff. And we just want to discuss a little bit about what that reorganization will look like to help support the students' academic needs and their goals. So I will turn this over. Mr. Warren, if you just want to give like a brief highlight of what is on their campus.
I just have one additional thing to add to the AP as well. We had 8 AP tests last year. I added an additional AP course this coming school year, which took some development and approval from College Board. So there's an English literature and composition course. We're also going to have the English language and composition course, which is more writing heavy. I've been getting a lot of feedback from our college bound students that are freshmen and sophomores and that they're lacking in their writing skills. So that's why the number, not to discredit what Mrs. Malazzo said there, but there was 24 that took the English test, because there's two separate tests. There's the literature and there's also the language, English language. So somebody or multiple people, some maybe didn't take one, but they chose to take both exams even though they didn't take the course. So that was showing all the English language exams there. And I'm not sure how they scored on that, not having the course, but we'll have two separate English AP courses now, which is going to be taught by Mrs. Moore. So she's been prepping for that and got approval through the College Board to have that second AP English course.
And I think we should congratulate our AP environmental science teacher. I think this was the first year we offered that, and we had like a 90% passing rate. So first year offering, I think that's outstanding.
Right. Yeah, we've been looking into the addition of the bio course. One of the biggest pieces to adding AP courses is the selection of the teacher, obviously. And a lot of times with that is, we find a teacher or an administrator finds a teacher, but they also have to be willing to want to teach that because they have to buy into it. You know what I mean? Mm-hmm. If they're not buying into being the instructor for that course, you're not going to have the success that you want to see. So we're trying to find that right fit for the bio course right now. We obviously have good teachers in that department. We just want to make sure we pick the right person. And, we're going to add that course probably next year. So as far as the guidance, like Mrs. Malazzo said, there was some restructuring there. Not really the addition of additional workload, but the restructuring because of the furlough process and that we lost a counselor. Some of the additional responsibilities that people are going to take on had to be divvied out. Like I said, it's not anything new, but stuff had to kind of be restructured around. The biggest thing that I want, the community to understand is the grade levels. So the grade levels will be, it'll be Mrs. Hischop will be 7th and 8th grade counselor.
So it's going to be broken up by grade level. Mr. Sorber will be the 9th and 10th grade counselor, and Mr. Heitzelman will be the 11th and 12th grade counselor. Some of the responsibilities and how they kind of aligned there was, Mrs. Hischak is obviously in her grade level is going to have the PSSA testing in the 7th and 8th grade. We added some additional pieces there. She's going to do some new student orientation with all 7th graders. So all of the 7th graders that come up, she's going to meet with them and have an orientation process with them and kind of give them their Skyward password and get them onboarded with being a new student on the secondary campus. She's going to keep documentation of that and meet with Mr. Arcangeli periodically to keep them up to speed on when she completes those meetings. She's also going to do orientation with any new students in 7th, 8th grade that come into the district. So that they come in, they have all the necessary materials they need to prepare to go into class. We've been seeing that when a new student comes into the district in those grade levels, especially if they're in the older grades, they may have moved between districts where they're just a little bit more mature. But in those grades, they're kind of lost when they start. So she's going to do that kind of onboarding with those students. Also, the school-based behavioral health team that we brought in the 7th and 8th grade, but it's actually for the entire secondary campus, but our focus is going to be in those grades. She's going to oversee with Mr. Arcangeli the school-based behavioral health team, so that's a huge component for her to oversee. She's going to be an active part of those meetings as well, which is just an added layer of support for our students. All students can be part of that if necessary. Mr. Sorber is going to be very heavy in the testing component. He has the PSATs, he has the AP testing, and he also has the Keystone testing. So he's really our heavy testing person. And with these things, this doesn't take away any of the just normal guidance responsibilities that a normal counselor would have. So, our focus moving forward is going to be heavy on the academic piece, and not to say that we are going to neglect the social emotions, but we feel that our counselors moving forward need to be strongly engaged in the academic achievement of our students. So that's our focus, and we're going to work closely with Mrs. Degnan and her department, and Kim Martini, our social worker, and make sure we support the students as necessary, but our counselors are going to be working on academics. That's our focus. We have Mr. Heitzelman. With the upperclassmen, he's going to be doing the senior awards ceremony. Is going to be part of his responsibilities. He is our main point of contact for the Cyber Academy as well, so he'll be doing the onboarding of cyber students with me. But I need that level of support and guidance to know what courses they need to take. So, I get him enrolled in the program, and then he does the scheduling with me. And then he's also going to be doing junior class meetings, similar to what Mrs. Hischak's doing, but much more labor-intensive, meeting with all juniors. He's going to be working with me directly, updating me as he has those meetings, kind of getting to know the students, what their likes, dislikes, and what their future plans look like as far as, post-grad, whether they're going to go on to college, and how we can align their, the second half of their junior year and their senior year to get them where they want to be. So we're going to be keeping up to date on those meetings. So, that's kind of our realignment there. And like I said, not a lot of additional things, but some realignment because of the loss of the counselor there. So
is that soon enough? Are we interjecting soon enough in a student's path on, what they need for their desired career path, the college, what type of college, what type of program in college, whether or technical or out into the workforce? I mean, is that junior year soon enough? Are we giving advice soon enough on, do you need SATs? Do you need ACTs? What type of coursework do you need to take? Like, if they wait too long, they don't have the prerequisites to get into certain opportunities.
Yeah, I mean, I think that is late, but I think those meetings are necessary, to the students that, may have an understanding at that point already, but it doesn't mean we're not going to be having those discussions earlier on with counselors, and with going into classrooms to having large group meetings with students and giving them opportunities to know, what's out there and what they could choose You know, Mrs. Hischak, we're going to work with her to kind of present those things out in the middle school. Even we've talked about this, how, you know, kind of letting them know as they transition into high school what opportunities they have with VOTEC, you know, and maybe the Crestwood creators work partnering with I2M, you know, those type of things. So we're going to have those discussions earlier, but I think those meetings is at that critical point in their junior year, you know, are important.
When are we laying out the pathway for students and parents that if they want the possibility of taking calculus, if they wanted the possibility of taking physics one and two, what prerequisites earlier in the season, earlier in their high school career? Because in order to hit those classes, you need to be taking classes your freshman and your sophomore year. And I do believe there was some confusion there, and kids move up that pathway, and all of a sudden they like, I need this prerequisite to get into that class.
I'll answer that one if you want to add to that too. So when the teachers report back on their in-service days, I believe it's August 21st, department head meetings. So the department chairs will be on the agenda, hopefully by the regular voting meeting. Once that happens, I've asked Mr. Gorham to reach out to them and work through the department chairs. The department chairs are called a tree, whatever you want, a curriculum pathway, but they're going to put together, we used to have one here, but let's update that. But we're going to work through our department chairs that will then work through the guidance department. So when they are going to pick a class, the parents or the students going to see, here is what this path looks like. So that is a part of our in-service and families. You know, if you take this course, what does my path look like in 3 years in that specific course?
And I love that you're saying parents, because I think in the past, a lot of that information on the courses didn't make it home to the parents, you know, and I don't think they know. I don't think that, you know, so I think that's great if we could educate the parents along with the kids, you know, even from like freshman year, like you said, like a tree or a pathway. And, you know, just so you know, just like FYI, if this is the class of senior year you want your kid to take, there's certain classes that have to be taken before that. So, yeah, I think that would be great. And I think that is stuff that could just be sent out as information. You know, I don't know if you need necessarily a one-on-one meeting freshman year to go over that. I think just putting the information out there, I think, would be great.
Almost like guidance. A college course catalog.
In a way, yeah, exactly.
What, yeah. This is what you start off in your freshman year, and this is your path.
You know, and even, yeah, exactly. And you could even list them that these are the prerequisites to take these classes. So you know if this is kind of where you're wanting to head, this, you know, to start to get
some, a plan. Some of that existed in the past. I know the math department always had a flow chart.
Yeah.
And if you wanted to switch, they would even show you where some of those switches could take place.
Yeah, and that's
right. It should be right in the handbook.
Right.
Right.
So I think
we've started it.
We have these things in place.
It's just they need to be updated.
So this is really, now can we?
It needs to be updated. It's not on the website.
Oh, no, yeah,
it's not.
I was going to say, it has to be coming out of the parents.
Oh, my goodness. Well, but our scheduling sheets, when we have our class meetings, so when our guidance counselors go in, and schedule from 8th grade going to 9th, from 9th going to 10th, 10 to 11th, and so on. Those scheduling sheets and that explanation of what is going to be offered and what needed to be, that's explained by the guidance counselor to each individual student, either targeting the history class, you know, they're in history, so everybody has that, or in English. Those sheets are then sent home to the families to get signed and returned. So when those students bring them in, it's always presented to them of what is being offered for the next year, what's applicable to them, and then they can make those selections. It is our, again, the assumption is that that is then taken home. And again, we can talk about where those assumptions go and how we can follow up and make that process, again, a little bit more fluid. But the assumption is going home to have those conversations. And then when that returns with the student signature, the parent signature, and it goes to our guidance counselors, they come in and we do a mass scheduling. So it's, you know, as explained, only because I got a chance to see that as being a history teacher and getting out of that classroom, watching them come in and explain what those things look like. So I think a lot of those, you know, prerequisites that could be are explained really from the start. Where we kind of fall apart potentially is what happens when you maybe were absent that day when that took place. What happened when you were a student that came into to Crestwood High School or Crestwood School District as a 10, as a sophomore. And that we can certainly target and say, how do we get everybody on board? I think the communication on the website to show what that map looks like, which is available to our teachers, available to our guidance counselors, and is getting shown to our students, but what happens when one of those things took place that didn't take that message home? So I think adding to having that in-service day, it's in our in-service agenda, that they're going to be doing that within the department to update those maps that have been out for a long time, as Mr. was saying back here, Mr. Wade, in the conversation, that have been out for a long time. Update those maps, get them onto our district website, and then as we move into more of an academic push with our guidance counselors, we're using those maps, which are as great evidence we have now, and they are going to be guiding those meetings. And then how can we add to that? You know, how can we, you know, make our, not just our guidance department, but all of our departments a little bit richer in delivering what's available to them? Then there's also tracking. So do we have tracking? No, it's an old term. However, as students come up, as we, you know, get more engrossed in middle school, curriculum, as students come up from our sixth grade to our seventh grade, we're identifying based off of preliminary results of PSSAs or prior to, and their grade within their individual classrooms, how they're doing in Fairview or Rice. Those results then kind of categorize, and we try to identify the students that are going to be able to do very well in pre-algebras or math sevens, pre-algebras, then get them to algebra one, and it's using math as an example. Algebra one in eighth grade, so that's going to track them to be able to continue that line to take the highest maths we have. As they go from ninth grade, and then sciences are very, not typical, but the track is there, it's laid for everybody in seventh and eighth grade. Once we get into the secondary campus, and we have the ability to double up in sciences now, that message is always, but our science, I believe our science department does a great job of getting that out to our students. Double up if you want to take this track, you want to be this person, double up in our sciences. And we see a lot of students really starting their sophomore year, starting to double up in science, which gives them that prerequisite, if you will. And I'll circle back to that prerequisite. It's going to allow them to take the higher level sciences, maybe that AP bio that we talked about before, so that they can track, you know, into that pre-medical, which would be nice. Then we talk about prerequisite. It's great to throw a blanket on it that we have to say, hey, you needed to take this. But in no way, shape, or form, we prevent a student who has an interest in wanting to do something or a career change. My goodness, we're sophomores and juniors in college, we take a different path. Mm-hmm. If they all of a sudden think, you know, this is going to be for me, we're not going to say, well, you didn't take this in eighth grade, so you're not going to be able to take that. We have to offer that career, or, you know, that opportunity. So we would certainly encourage them, if their grades didn't match up where we needed to be, maybe encourage them to, or steer them to a different direction if they didn't match that. But if their grades and the sciences that they did take before they made a different choice, if they are strong, we would still recommend them to be able to do that. It wouldn't hold them back. You know, and hold that. So I think there are things in place. It's just that, you know, what's communicated and what is transparent.
I agree.
That's where you're at.
So you're all I'm saying. I never thought you guys did it.
Oh, no.
It really was just the communication and just
correct.
Me hearing parents say, I don't really understand what's going on, or I don't understand this,
right.
or I wish I had known that, or I wish. So it's really just communication.
It's all about
totally
transparency.
And that's what I said. I'd love to see
agree.
More of that.
Yeah,
be available to parents, or that they know where to look for,
certainly.
And especially around that course ticking time.
Because
I think it's one thing to say, oh, it's in the input book at the beginning of the year,
you're
and
right.
then come what March, April,
oh, yeah,
but,
the
you
March,
know,
yeah.
yeah, you know,
February,
and then it's
March.
Like, and then it's like, what's going on? And you get a list
yeah.
of all these classes, and
I
don't
know
what they
and
meant,
our courses
you know.
And our course descriptions are on there, but then they kind of fall apart. I get it. So
yeah.
It's one thing to say, hey, it's out there. But are we offering those reminders? So as we begin to look into it and work with guidance, as we kind of take a new direction, and they're excited to be able to do that, as we take a new direction, I think those are things we have to change.
Yeah. And you
know,
I think parents
let's
just
that,
appreciate it. Yeah,
what am I doing? Let's
really
have the transparency for things that most of the time, we're already doing them, we're doing them well. Let's tell people how that process is going and control that narrative. And I think sometimes we maybe lose sight of being able to control that narrative in a positive way. I think the transparency will be able to help, you know, be able to do that. So we're working towards it. I just wanted to explain a little bit. We're tracking that direction.
Yeah.
I think
yeah.
we have to just continue to do it.
Yeah, we have the foundation. We have
yeah.
a good foundation.
Oh,
it's
yes.
just that we need to communicate. I think that's
yep.
where we're downfall. And update, right?
And
if we're adding classes. We
and we've updated, not only the handbook is approved and done, but we've got a chance to update our school website Jonathan and Damian, the team, have taken our suggestion to be able to do that. So we're already in the process of taking a lot of that old stuff that isn't applicable, adding all those new things, redoing our years, and that's going to be a continuous, almost like Google document. It's going to be a working live document between now and the end of the year. So I think we're tracking the right direction.
I think sometimes the breakdown too is the kids are getting a lot of information during that class period. And I even know from my own knuckleheads that come home, it's just sign this is what they told me to take it. And you know, maybe looking forward with all the things that we're changing, maybe we open one night as a scheduling night. You have questions during that time period, come and ask us. You know what I mean? That's a simple way to kind of quell some of this. If you don't know, I mean, not everybody can call the guidance counselor during the day. Not everybody can come in and make an appointment. Maybe that's a way that we can kind of, you know, we do a parent-teacher night, but at the high school level, not many people come.
Okay,
you know, we could kind of restructure that a little bit.
Completely agree. It really make almost like a college fair. Oh. We can all be at, you know, those tables, so it's not just blast. You know what I mean? That can be very lengthy, and some, you know, my conversation with you can be very different from somebody else's. That can elongate a night. College fair type of atmosphere, where you can go and visit, like maybe the teachers are supposed to be, and things like that. Yeah. Might be something we can look into that could be successful. In the past, we've done it where we had class meetings, we had our scheduling time, and then we usually base it on electives more so, but here's what's available, and then those elective teachers come in and kind of give their spiel as to why this is valuable, and you know, is this something you want to take, is this something you want to be interested in, and that was successful too, but then we ran into, you know, a lot of things happen, but it's, now we have to pull teachers out, and that becomes a little cloudy, so that nighttime process, or maybe whatever that might look like, we can offer that same thing. You know, I think it can work out really well, certainly. I agree, sometimes we give too much credit to what can get home. We like to think that it's gonna get there, and sometimes it maybe falls a little short.
I do have a question. I think that what you're talking about is really great for students who feel that they already know what direction they're going in. So I'm just wondering how we can develop the interest in other, in potentially other areas like career and trade. So do you have an age range where you're starting to look at trade fairs and career fairs for students? Or like when, at what point in their career and how do you think we could do that?
As career readiness, and I was some laws to speak to this as well, as career readiness is really part of our evaluation process more so now since it's been revamped a few years ago. We're now installing careers as a class in our wheels starting in seventh grade. So even going back even before that, where Zello is going to be introduced, it's already being introduced in our elementary schools. So we have to continue to build that career portfolio. So for those students, and now more than ever, 10 years from now, what's going to look like where maybe university, college, all those schools aren't the best option. Careers, I believe, is strongly taking a look at that. We're starting to develop what that portfolio looks like and building every single year. But having the careers class as early as going back to fifth and sixth grade, but really hitting on it in seventh and eighth, we're starting to see that process. And then that portfolio gets added to every single year. We're trying to develop that interest in what else is out there other than maybe a college or, you know, college-ready student. So I think we are developing that along with state guidelines. That is still relatively fresh, you know, that new focus. So I think we continue to build on what that career fair might look like. Last year, though, however, we worked. You remember the acronyms and laws? So we can when we went down to the well, not what you can say. We went down to the
junior
the
Northeast. Yes.
Yeah, Northeast.
Junior achievement.
Thank you. Yeah. So we took over 100 students down, you know, to I want to say the casino. I wasn't the casino, but the name of it, what's the name of our casino downtown? Mohegan Sun. I apologize. Mohegan Sun, and high schools from all over the area, 1,000 plus children were down there meeting with those vendors. So that was really good as like that career piece in junior and senior year. That's going to continue to expand. That just kind of came in our area. It was really big in Ohio. It's kind of washing its way across the state. So I think we're building careers as early. But with that Zello portfolio, we're starting to do that elementary. We hit it hard in our career wheel in seventh and eighth grade, and we're continuing to build that portfolio. We kind of start to see again that we catch on now with the state as they make it a big deal with something like we had last year, that junior achievement. And now we're getting kids in front of allied services, in front of Geisinger. Again, not necessarily going to a career college, but going in front of those folks that might be career path first. So I think it's developing. So we are doing that. But like anything, you can always add and see where we're at and what our students want. Going back to Mrs. Law's point before, pulling the students. If we're not all going to be career bound, I think it's like the attachment of that guidance counselor. Where are we seeing where our students are saying, I want to go right into the workforce? Where are our students saying, I want to be career, I want to be college ready? And that kind of guides some of our choices of where we're looking for more opportunities to go down a career first or hold one ourselves here.
And the other thing, while we're on that topic, you know, and I know I brought this up in the past, and I'd love us to keep looking at this possibly in the future. Are our kids getting into where they want to go? Are they getting into the colleges they want to go to, or the technical schools they want to go to? Or, you know, I'd love us to look at that and see, you know, I mean, granted, I know there's always going to be some that are maybe reaching higher than, you know, they, you know, probably, you know, and I would never tell a kid not to reach, but.
Right.
I know sometimes we're going to say, well, you know, they had a 2.5.
Sure.
We understand why they didn't get to Harvard, you know, like something like that. You know,
right.
But again, never tell them not to reach. But I'd love to see in general, are most of our kids, I'd love to know, are they getting in where they want to go? You know, are we, if not, how can we help them achieve that?
I'm not looking for an answer now.
But how can we help them achieve that?
Right.
Right.
What is the answer?
Right.
I mean, is there an answer? Or is it just that competitive? You know,
well, and that's, I guess, what I'd love to look at and say,
yeah.
You know, well,
are,
and
are
I mean,
they,
granted, maybe.
Are they excessively shooting too high?
Possibly, you know, but if not, you know, if our top kids aren't getting into the, you know,
mm-hmm.
the colleges they want, I may
yeah,
say.
Yeah, but that's the misconception. There
yeah.
are top kids.
Yeah.
But are they the top kids?
But even
the
middle
that's
kids, the then, if I mean,
so
any kid, like I said,
so
I don't want to make it a top
into,
kid.
They're
thing.
Getting into the appropriate college.
Right.
But they're not getting into the college that they necessarily want.
And that's why I said, that's why
because
you have to look.
Because there are top kids, but are they the top kids that should get into that school? Probably not.
Right.
But
are our
not.
Kids are our kids having the information early enough to
right.
check the boxes to go to those places? Do they know
right.
that schools look at, oh, you got all A's, but they want to see you challenging yourself.
Right.
They want to see you take all the AP classes that your school offers. And they'll look better at a B or
right.
a B plus out of an AP class than they will a regular class when they're looking for admissions. I've had college admissions mm-hmm. tell me. So, I mean, and I've also experienced it three times. There's no one telling our students, hey, you know, if you want to go to a level one college, you need to take every AP class. You need to take as much as you can and demonstrate that you're challenging yourself, right? As opposed to, you know what, I'm not going to take physics. I'm going to go back and take environmental science because it's easier because I know I can get an A, as opposed to pushing myself in a physics class. Or I'm not going to take the AP US history class. I'm just going to take world cultures. And I mean, I've had multiple college admissions in discussions say, you know, you need to demonstrate that you're willing to push yourself. And they look at your high school's profile, and they look at what the hardest courses they feel are, and they say, are you taking those courses? Right? I don't know that we're giving that guidance out.
Okay.
And that's what I would just like to say, because if you say majority of our kids aren't getting in where they're trying to get into, I would say there's a problem. You know, like, and how can we help them? You know, are we going to get every kid into Harvard? No. I mean, but it's where they want to get into, and you know, at their, you know, wherever they're at and what their goals are, and just is there more information we could be giving them to help them? You know, like John said, do we need to tell the kids, hey, if these are your goal schools, you need to be taking the top classes we're taking? And I agree with them. We're in the college point right now. We were told that by some schools. If you're not taking the top classes at your school, your application is getting tossed right off the bat, no matter.
Some of that has to fall onto the parents, too.
Agreed.
But
as a school, if majority of our kids aren't getting in to their goals, I think the school has some responsibility with that. If it's a whole, if it's a few here or there, I agree with you.
Yeah.
You know, but I, and that's why I'm just curious. Are most of our kids maybe they are, most of them are achieving, you know, me, I'm bringing this up, maybe they are achieving it and it's not an issue, but that's why I just always, like I
know
said, I've asked
we
this before.
We do our college survey,
yeah.
And I know Ms. Reisman's not here, but he does conduct our college survey for students that what they did get into,
yeah.
That's something they filled out. I don't know if we had a conversation with Ms. Campbell about that was, that would be a bit about that college survey.
Yeah, no, I haven't. Just like I said, I've asked a few times.
It certainly can. I mean, but
yeah.
We have a college survey that does go out.
Yeah.
They are collecting that information.
Okay, that'd be great.
Yeah.
That's what I'm looking
yeah.
for. Like,
yes,
are most of them saying, yeah, I'm happy. I got into the program I wanted to get into, or I got into the school I wanted to get into.
We're putting up,
I'd like
students
to know
are getting
that, yeah.
a great 4-year college and getting
yeah.
yourself great experiences.
Yeah.
There's no doubt about it.
Yeah, because I'd say if the majority of them are, then we know
Sure.
We're heading in a
yep.
good track, you know.
And to Mr. Macker's
right.
point, I mean, being
right.
in a different hat, I know he sees it with, you know, going through the college process of recruiting and things like that.
Mm-hmm.
I have to deal with that as well with some of our athletes. And you're not wrong. And it's, you know, what are you seeing a challenge? So if you want to be an Ivy, you want to be a Patriot League school, here's what they're looking for, you know, and taking those APs and scoring extremely high. Are you on your highest track? So no doubt about it, it's true information, it's factual. You want to get into those, you have to give yourself your best chance. I'd venture to guess that the majority of our students, and again, it's assuming, I think that's what we're trying to say, like, we have to take the assumption now, let's be hard facts.
Yeah.
But if you want to go be a doctor, or whatever, in medical field, science field, mathematics, you know, a big time engineer, I would hope that you have a pretty good idea that you need to be challenging yourself academically and not just having that lofty goal and not working to it. It would be having like, I'm gonna deal, you know, with our young men out on the football field, you know, not to utilize that. I don't like to utilize that employees in the meetings, but you know, we're not all 6'5" and can run really fast and do those things, but or if we're not showing up to all of our practices, but we want great things, yeah, be realistic. Again, I communicate that. I know I communicate with that with them, what we need to accomplish to be able to reach those goals. It's just we have to know what we have to put in order to get there. I think I'm confident saying that we do give a lot of that information, but like Mr. Warren said, we can always be better and not then take away the assumption and know that we do have it. Here's the track, here's what we're seeing. And here's the information we're getting from colleges that this is what we need to have success. And again, as we revamp our guidance department, to do that and take a look at that, we can help parents guide their students in the right direction. So hopefully,
because I know there's even a lot of parents confused out there, like, should my kids take the SAT? Should you know? Because
yeah.
some schools are saying they're test optional, but are they really test yeah. optional? And I know that's a confusing topic, and I don't even expect you guys to have an answer because. Like I said, I'm not sure if the colleges even know if
every
they have an answer. It's
different.
Different.
Sure.
So I was just curious, like, what are we telling kids if they come and say, hey, should I take the SATs?
Right.
Like, and again, I know it's a complicated
sure.
topic right now, but yeah, even just being on up on stuff like that, like
yeah.
what
just
should we?
A couple perspectives
yeah.
to share. One answer to your question is, Mrs. Velazzo is about to present something that has a great deal of career embedded in it. The Crestwood creators demonstrating how that's the rigor of that is going up and we're driving down in grades because the spirit of the legislation that came along with career readiness is people were wasting hundreds of thousands of dollars on an accounting degree at Penn State to find out when they finished they hate accounting. The concept is if you expose them earlier and have a better understanding of their interests earlier, they would do something of that. And again, I haven't been in the secondary campus, but one of the things I do every year is open our graduation book that lists every college that every one of our kids are going to. And it truly is a who's who every year. It was impressive. The other thing that struck me is the distance we're starting to travel to go to college. You used to open that thing up 20 years ago, it said Bloomsburg 37 times, Penn State 42 times, Temple, and now we're going all over this country. So again, that's not hard data, but year after year, especially the last few years, I particularly noticed that, and the colleges that our kids are attending, listed by name, are impressive.
All right, so going into my final presentation is the Crestwood Creators class. If you recall, in July, the Board of Education approved the creation of this class, and I just wanted to provide some information about what the Crestwood Creators class is. So before I go into what it is, I just posted here the mission statement of Crestwood. I believe it aligns with the Crestwood Creators Class, so I felt it was important to highlight that and share. So the mission of the Crestwood School District is to support personalized learning so students are college and career ready upon graduation. So what is STEM? STEM stands for, if you didn't know, it's science, technology, engineering, and math. So why do I bring up what STEM is? So why is STEM education important for students' future plan? So over the next 10 years, 71% of new jobs will require computer science and STEM skills. STEM job currently right now has a growth of over 9%. Research also shows that STEM instruction majors offer benefits in a student's pathway, even though if the student does not necessarily pursue a STEM career. And all that information came right from the PD website. Why does the Crestwood School District need Crestwood Creators in elementary? So Crestwood Creators Education, all students can participate in STEM literacy and are capable of participation. STEM education transcends into the classroom and integrates into the community. We've talked a lot about in our committee meetings, we talk about I2M, right? That's a community. We talk about allied services. We talk about Zodiac printing. All of them are part of our Crestwood education, Creators Education. And success, right? This can be only successful if the vision that I'm about to share with you is shared between the educators, the students, the families, post-secondary, business, and also the industry. So Crestwood Creators Education, what are they going to learn? So students are going to learn careers. They're going to learn STEM. They're going to learn technology application. They're going to learn engineering and be challenged to those engineering designs. Mathematical reasoning. Design, creativity, collaboration, and critical thinking skills. Very high level Crestwood Creators curriculum plan. So the plan is to demonstrate the understanding of the fundamental STEM concepts and application. We talk about critical thinking, problem solving, and various STEM contexts. They're going to provide proficiency in the technology and software applications, Google Suite, Google Forms, Google Docs, Google Presentations that are relevant to STEM fields. They're going to explore the various career pathways. We've been talking a lot about that today. So through our Zello platform, they'll be learning. So when they go through the Zello platform, what are they looking to be? Are they going to be a teacher? Are they going to be an electrician? Are they going to be an engineer? That's part of this Crestwood Creators plan. Communication and collaboration with their peers. They're going to learn to work together. A lot of times, you know, in the classroom, it's them with their tests. Now they're going to do project-based. They're going to be working together. And also this year, it's a grading system. So it's in our special rotation, which I'll go to the next slide and discuss that. So it is located into our newly designed Crestwood Creators STEM and Career Center, also known previously as the library. So it is a rotation with our gym and music. So communication will be going out shortly to the families if it did not already. So with the elementaries, we're gonna have gym, music, Crestwood Creators, and they're all going to be a graded system. So if you're K through two, it'll be satisfactory, unsatisfactory. And if they are 3 through 6, it will be a numerical base grade. It is curriculum structured, again, K through six. And with this decision with the board to bring it back, I've mentioned it a couple times, but I want to make sure the families understand and know that we are starting back on time. In April, I sent out a different communication, so I just want to make sure everybody knows the students will have their traditional times. An example of STEM supplies. So again, we'll talk about I2M. I2M through the foundation, the Crestwood Education Foundation, they're sponsoring or able for us to buy it, and this is just a couple of the supplies. I'm not saying that's actually what it's going to be, but those are just supplies that they will have for the kind of things we're going to start building in this class. So that is, again, very high level, just discussion about it. We have two teachers that are going to be taking over this big initiative that we have. They're very excited. They're doing an amazing job. Our principals are doing an amazing job with them. At Rice Elementary, it's going to be Paula Sapak and Amy Bloom over at Fairview. So our teachers have been named for those, and we're all very excited about this new opportunity. The first half of the year is going to focus on that career piece, and then the second half of the year is going to be with the STEM piece. So maybe questions, I know this is very high level, but I don't want to give too much more information. We're still working on the curriculum plans and the lesson plans, again, with our principals. But I just wanted to share just a very brief highlight of the class. And I want to thank the board. So thank you to you for allowing this class to be created. It's something brand new. So without your support, this class would not be here. So any feedback that you have from the community, from the staff here, we want this to be successful. So if there's anything anybody sees or wants to share, even into our community, any businesses that are have any information, want to be a part of this, please reach out to the district because we're very excited about this opportunity.
Do our juniors and seniors going into the this curriculum, is that considered part of the Crestwood Creator curriculum and class?
So,
into the manufacturing curriculum?
So, yes, but it's not in the beginning years. So, in fifth and sixth grade, the teachers are going to be working together actually in our in-service day. So, they're going to have a lot of collaboration. I2M is going to meet with them. Also, Mr. Zalagoski, Ms. Chase will be a part of that. The teachers are really going to discuss what is happening in seventh and eighth grade so that we're not duplicating those efforts in elementary school. So there's a lot of collaboration that's going to happen, and then there'll be discussions. I know they're involving junior achievement. I don't want to say everything that's going to happen because I want the teachers to be able to share it. The junior achievement is going to be a part of it. They're going to have job fairs a part of it. So that Crestwood education that you're talking about with I2M and what they have at the secondary campus will be discussed with them early to see if they want to be a part of that program. So right now we have 14 students rostered into the I2M for this year. So our hope would be, this whole piece would just communicate the whole pathway through, should they want that pathway through. Good.
Okay.
Thank you.
If there's no further discussion, this short committee meeting is adjourned.
Thank you. This is BIBLA, Behavioral Interventional Health and Safety.
I'll be seeking approval of the minutes of June 15, 2023.
Second.
All in favor?
Aye.
Aye. Seeing no agenda items for this month, open discussion items, soaring sixth grade comment, soaring comment of the week, secondary camp.
Okay, so I'm going to have Mr. Mangini share about what the soaring sixth grade comment is, and then I'll follow up with the secondary campus.
Hey, everybody.
Hello.
So at the elementary level, we want to recognize our students for being well-rounded, not just academically, but also being kind to peers, being role models to their peers, and just being an all-around, well-rounded student. So this year at the elementary level, every month starting in September through May, the sixth grade teachers will be nominating a soaring comment. There'll actually be two every month. And so for part of that process, the teachers will fill out a form, give a small blurb about why the student was nominated. That information will be transmitted to myself as well as to Mrs. Malazzo. We will recognize the students at the elementary level with a certificate and a t-shirt. And also at the following month's board meeting, we're going to ask the student and their families to come here and be recognized with you all as well.
Is it two at each building?
Yes, there'll be two at Rice and two at Fairview.
Thank you.
Thank you.
And the secondary comment, at the secondary campus, that will start on August 20th. They will be nominated a student that displays good character. They could display good sportsmanship and outstanding skill, play the game. Once a week, the committee will choose four students who will represent the Soaring Comet title. Each advisor or coach can nominate one name per week. And the goal is to have four students each week, two from clubs and activities and two from athletics. And very similar to the sixth grade, they will receive a certificate that I didn't bring the shirt, he had the white one, but we have a red shirt for the secondary campus students, and we'll post their picture on social media and just recognize them. So it's athletics, but it's also in the classroom or an extracurricular activity. So those are two new things. And the t-shirts and any kind of funding is done through our PCCD mental health grant that needs to be spent by the end of the year. So all of this as, you know, no charge to the district. It's free, but it's through the grant then.
Any other questions? Seeing none, adjourn.
Thank you. Co-curricular, Mrs. Bidwell.
Seeking a motion to approve the minutes of June 15th, 2023. I so move.
Second.
All in favor?
Aye.
Aye. One agenda item for this month. Number one, Michelle Wagman for weightlifting, split salary. Any questions from the board?
Yes. She'll be supervising in the weight room. Are we reinstituting pre-COVID female designated days for weightlifting? There were times, I know the girls get intimidated going into the weight room with the guys in there. And I know pre-COVID we started and it was only a couple months and then like everything shut down. Has there been discussion about girls only sessions in the weight room?
Not that I know of. I know it's going to be centered around the student rather than male versus female. I think programs are going to be implemented for everybody. I think if anything comes up, we'll know about it and if there's an issue.
Okay, thanks.
Yeah, there's been a sign up sheet right now, so I did see that. And I believe we may have another person that'll be a part of that team. So actually be three people. Is that right, Mr. Mosley? So what, three people?
Yep.
So one other person on the
agenda.
Make
sure the clearances are in before he gets to
So I think this program is growing, it's changing. Thanks.
I did see Mr. Kyle had posted several listings looking for students and breaking them out into different groups. So he's not inundated with 100 all at once. He's going to have different sessions. So, I mean, it appears from the outside looking in that there's some thought into the organization of how they're going to use it and utilize the different facilities available to them.
Simultaneously, inside and out, utilizing those?
What I had understood is he's looking to start four groups. Two groups would be like an after school, say 3 to 4, Tuesday, Thursday.
2:30
after school, he'd do an hour to an hour 15 with group one. He'd have four groups, so he'd have a group two on Tuesday, Thursday, and then he'd use Friday as an optional day. So you'd have two sessions Thursday. And then two sessions Friday, but Friday would be optional for those Tuesday, Thursday, one to follow, or Friday to get a third day.
But nothing on Monday and Wednesday?
As of right now, I think he's going through 3 days.
Oh, I thought it was 4 days. Okay. What about working with the sports teams? Are you going to be working alongside coaches to be able to put that together?
Yes.
Yeah. Utilizing our programs to do that, or programs developed?
He would have program of his own for everybody. You guys had your own program you want to utilize.
You don't implement that
yet.
Perfect.
Any other questions? Seeing none, I make a motion to move item one to the agenda. I so move.
Second.
All in favor?
Aye.
Aye. Open discussion. Posting for all extracurricular postings.
I mentioned that earlier. We're just going through the interview process, but I anticipate on the voting meeting, we'll have department chairs, class advisors, and more if there's any other like weightlifting coaches, anything like that. So anticipate a larger list. We're just going through that interview process now. And the other thing I wrote here, it's not on the agenda, but I just want to highlight Coach Amy Beatty. She was inducted into the Lord Zurn County Sports Hall of Fame. So I just want to congratulate her. I know I typically wait to the voting meeting, but you know, I think it's something we should recognize today. So congratulations to her.
Any other questions? Seeing none, adjourned.
Hi, yes, Mr. Nardone.
So Mr. Swank isn't here. I don't know if Ms. Alex,
she's
on the phone, so she's present. I'll be seeking a motion to approve the Financial Planning Committee minutes from June 15th. I so move.
Second.
We're in all in favor.
All in favor.
All
aye.
In favor, aye. So I've been looking to move items 1 through 4 to the voting session next week. Are there any questions from the board? Seeing none?
Any motion?
I'll seek a motion to approve moving this.
Second.
All in favor?
Aye.
Aye. Open discussions. Questions to the public?
Yes. Just one question. You've got the two PIN numbers there. Is it public knowledge? Are you allowed to say what those two properties are that you're looking to have reassessed?
Yeah. Yes. I mean,
Bob Derwin property.
Yes.
Right?
absolutely. Because they're properties in Whitehaven, I believe. They are where it was a huge sale of the marijuana.
The cannabis factory in Whitehaven. That's what it is.
The reason there's two parcels. Legal or illegal?
No, legal.
Legal. And the reason there's two is for whatever reason, that Jack may know better than me, but they're assessed together, even though they're separate properties. They were sold together in the spring and they somehow are jointly assessed, but this is how it needs to be done procedurally.
How is the old MC?
Yes.
The old MC properties.
You know them well?
Yeah.
I want to mention something on number 3, the BSN agreement for the board to consider. What that is, it's a spirit store for the district. I want to really emphasize for the community, our boosters, our PTA, is not to take anything away from. There is no sports affiliations on the spirit store. There are no Rice or elementary, secondary campus, anything. It's just a Crestwood Comet where you can buy gear. We've got a lot of requests from the community asking, you know, when there's not a sale going on, where can I buy Crestwood clothes? They're going to Wise Market right now. So I would love for them to shop on our website. So it's, again, no cost to the district, and I just want to really reiterate that it should not impact the booster clubs. You still continue to do what you were selling. Our PTAs, please continue to do that and make sure there was no sports and there's no, it's just Crestwood School District. So I just want everybody to know that before it comes out, or if you guys, you know, choose to approve that.
Since money is obviously still an issue going, bulk of the problem has been medical. Does Mr. Benz have a feeling for how we're trending with medical bills over the last couple months? I know back in May or June, it was still alarmingly high. Is that something you're wondering?
Yeah, I just put a report out on that today. As you seem to recall, May was our worst month for claims of the year, you know, by far. June, we finally had a month that brought us back down to where we were back in, I think, September. Now, how long? Hopefully that's beginning of a new trend. Don't know for sure. Did find out it's a little bit understated by about $50,000 or $60,000 because of a particular bill from Highmark that didn't get processed within the right month. But even including that $60,000, our total charges are around $400 as opposed to almost $800 in May. So that was nice to see. Clearly, 1 month doesn't make a trend, but it's a good sign on healthcare.
At what point would you have July's number?
End of August.
Okay.
Why don't we give a state update?
Okay, in open discussions, I know, Rebecca, you're going to be coming up, but the one thing I felt I should give an update on is that the state budget has passed. I assume you guys saw that and what that means to Crestwood. It's kind of a good news, bad news, and incomplete. The good news is that what got passed is $200,000 more in revenue for Crestwood than what I had budgeted for basic education subsidy and special education subsidy. Bad news is there doesn't appear to be anything in the budget to help school districts statewide for infrastructure or capital type projects that at least I know I was hoping for, and that doesn't seem to be there. And then the incomplete is, if you followed in the news, they said 75% of the budget was passed, the other 25%, they still didn't pass legislation to say exactly how it could be spent. Well, you have $130,000 for mental health costs that that the state could help us with, that's tied up as part of that last 25%. We know the dollar amount is $130,000, but we don't know what we could spend it on yet. So we're hoping to have that in September. So that part is incomplete. With that budget being passed, the cash flow challenges here at Crestwood that we've been managing through the summer, we've got a lot of relief on that. But the state still is backed up both in, or all in Pennsylvania Department of Education, the Comptroller's Office, and the Treasury are all backed up and pushing that money out to the districts. They're several weeks behind. We believe to be caught up in the next couple of weeks. As long as that holds true, we will be okay from a cash flow perspective. If that delays, we have a plan that hopefully we don't have to execute. And I don't think we need to get into that detail here, but we have been planning for what we would have to do if that gets delayed any further. One of the things in that list, though, I want to do a public thank you for is we were looking into asking the local tax collectors. There's 9 municipalities that comprise the Crestwood School Districts that are covered by 8 tax collectors, 1 covers 2. They all agreed to make multiple payments into the district a month instead of just once if we needed it. Now, we don't need that now, but that spirit of cooperation I thought was great to see from all of them. So that's the update I plan to give unless there's other questions from the board.
Rebecca, do you want to give a food service update?
Sure. Can we have all in favor of moving these to the board?
Yes. I make a motion.
Second.
All in favor?
Aye.
Aye. Right, hi, so I'm the food service director. My name is Rebecca Salerno. I see some familiar faces, so hi again. So I have some really exciting updates that I'd love to share with you guys. So first and foremost, breakfast is free for all students. I know that this is the same as years past. With that, we also plan on having a grab and sit breakfast. So with that, we have like a brown bag breakfast where we'll have some to-go items for the kids. Along with that, we'll also still have hot items too. For secondary campus, students will check in at homeroom and then they'll go eat. And for the elementary schools, we'll have it the same as last year where they'll have homeroom and then go back to class. Another announcement I'm excited to share is that we will be having free reduced lunch for all students. So originally it was between 30 and 40 cents per student, depending on the school you were at. And now it's completely free. This will be reimbursed by the state. So to reiterate, free and reduced will be free completely. And the only ones that are paying is those that qualify for paid lunches. Along with that, for the month of August, we have a back to school carnival. So this is just essentially to welcome kids back. We'll be having some fun new meals. This will include some like cheesesteak hoagie, loaded chili pierogies, Italian sausage hoagie, and some chicken tacos. So, like I said, that'll just be to celebrate the kids being back to school, and that'll just be for that week we're here in August. Aside from that, in September, we'll have Try It Tuesdays. That'll just be at the high school and the middle school. So we'll have different food bars every Tuesday. Some of the ones I have already is a fajita bar, a breakfast sandwich bar, a noodle bar, and a salad bar. So with this, I think this will help with a lot of student involvement because I'll get their feedback on what they like. And from there, I'll try to implement that into our menus going forward. On September 23rd and 24th, Mets will have our chefs come in and they'll be setting up in the cafeteria to give out samples to the students. This is complimentary of Mets. And with this, it could range from different meals. I'll talk to them with what we can finalize. Something popular they did previously was like zucchini noodles. So with that, they'll have different sauces and things like that for the kids to try. I can keep you updated with what we finalize
If you guys have any ideas too, we can do that as well. And lastly, for after school, we have the Soaring Commons Express. This was like our after school snack program where we provided like a rotating hot meal and also some snacks, granola bars, Gatorades. This we think will be really popular during the football season as well. So yeah, our main focus is for football season, and it'll be sold in the Alcart line as it was previously. Lastly, family communication regarding the school year, regarding the lunch application will be sent out in homeroom, and that will be either paper or electronically. So yeah, that's basically it.
Thank you, Rebecca. A quick question. I know some parents have been talking to me, they've been having some issues with their accounts. Is that information clear on the website, who they can contact if they're having some difficulty, like activating their account or putting money in their account or ending their account?
Yeah, it's on the website.
Okay.
I've had a few people contact me as well, and I've helped them through it as best as I can too.
Okay, perfect. Great. Thank you.
Yeah, of course.
I have a question also. Last year they were doing a smoothie on Wednesday after school, is that right? Are you planning to continue that? Was it popular? How did it go?
It was popular for like the first week, and then after that it started dying out. We would take it out and then put it back in, and it would be popular for a day. And it was just, I think it's something we would have to space out rather than keep it consistent.
Thanks.
Mm-hmm. Anything else on open agenda? Yes, sir.
Just wondering, since it impacts you guys financially, if you have a feeling for where cyber charter enrollment is trending. I know that's going to be an initiative to try to get some of the kids back into the school as opposed to being educated remotely.
I don't have a good answer. Mr. Barb, do you have a good answer on that?
Yeah, I mean, at this point in the summer, we only have 17 students in the Crestwood Cyber Academy. I don't have the number of private cyber charter. That usually stays very consistent from year to year. You know, it's, I don't know if Stephanie or Sarah might know, you know, just a general ballpark number, mm-hmm. but it may know more because the billing aspect of it, but, you know, our Crestwood Cyber, we have 17 right now. That'll grow. Probably double to in the 30-ish range, which would be considerably lower from what we're at previous years. Last year we were probably in this between 60 and 80. It fluctuates during the year because kids come in and out.
Did you start as low as 17 last year? Or did you start higher? You know,
no.
Much higher.
Much higher.
I don't know. Maybe somebody up here can answer. Read an article in the Citizen's Voice in the past week about economic impact, possibly through state budget or whatever, extra money or savings to districts in the county based on cyber numbers. And our increase was percentage-wise the lowest in the county, which makes me feel that we're doing a better job at pulling our students back than maybe other districts are. That's what I inferred from the article. Do you have any further insight on that?
Yeah, so it's a compounding answer. So it is one, because we put that initiative a couple years ago, slowly, you know, and organically through the COVID, the pandemic, and then making those phone calls, you know, sending out those mail flyers, setting up on our website. Like, so we've done a great job throughout the last couple of years communicating that we have a Crestwood versus a private charter. So there is a form that we filled out. It's called the PD 363. So the savings is also different per school district. And Mr. Benz can go into the detail of, as much
sure.
as he can about the financial pieces to that, but not everybody pays the same amount of charter for regular education and special education students based upon our data.
Yes. So I believe I didn't read that article, but a couple of people mentioned it to me. There's legislation out there, and Jackie could chime in here, that I think has made it pretty deep through the process that if it were to be signed by the governor, would cap at least some portion of the charter cost per student for a district at $8,000. Now, I don't know if that is just regular ed or special ed or how that breaks out.
It's just regular ed.
It's just regular ed. So by comparison, we get charged currently about $11,000. For regular ed, so that would drop it by 3,000 per student based on this year's numbers. And that we literally just worked on that this week. Those numbers are fresher. As a point of reference, special ed is about 24,000 a student and 11,000 for regular.
But all the districts, all different, have, so our 11,000 threshold, someone else may be 9,000 and maybe someone else would be 15,000 for regular ed. So that variance as well could just be on that data.
Yeah, and that cost, it is based on what we budget the previous year for various categories that the state dictates. They give us the form, we fill it out, the numbers come out at the bottom. We don't get, there's no negotiation, there's, you know, it is what it is. Does that answer?
Yeah. Any other questions on open? Who's your financial committee?
Mrs. Bidla, Human Resources. I'm glad you're here today.
So approve the minutes of June 15, 2023. I so move.
Aye.
Aye. 5 items to move to the agenda this month. Any questions from the board?
Yes. Item number 1, will we be filling that spot?
We put a posting out when we received the resignation, but the posting is not for Fairview Elementary. There was some shifting and reassignments of the paras, so we don't actually need a para in Fairview, but we have a posting that we're hoping to present to the board for secondary campus.
Okay, so that posting will go secondary.
Yeah.
Our day-to-day substitute list, I had a hard time. When they update stuff on the computer, I have a problem. I had a problem trying to read it, coming out blurry and everything. Day-to-day substitutes, do we have names added to the list from the last?
Yeah, what happened, Barry, is we originally had 6. Those were suspended professional employees from our May meeting. So they were coming back as day-to-day. Since that time, 4 of them have received permanent positions elsewhere. So that's the purpose of the resignations on page 1. On page 2, there are now 6,
right,
that were hired.
So
we're going to have 2 more.
So we have 2 more on top of that we already approved.
We're going to have 8 permanent day-to-day.
Right.
8?
Wow. And then our casual list, I think, Barry, that you were talking about, too, through our guest teacher program and just through our channels, that will be on the agenda as well, and you'll receive a separate list.
A separate list of?
The casual, like, day-to-day.
So you got it already, Barry, but they keep coming in every day, so by next week, it will be even bigger.
So. Okay, so next week we'll have an updated list of new casual hires.
Professional, everything. Yep.
Okay.
Mm-hmm. You'll have guest teachers as well, everything. Because I just got more added today.
So. In preliminary, I can say that our pool of substitutes for professionals, we're in a good spot. We had a lot of interest come back, and you know, a good spot when I say that we're still going to need, you know, some comp time short coverage, yes. But
we
had
2
spot.
Nurses today that apply, so that have all their stuff ready to go.
So total of full-time day-to-day, a total of 8. I'm assuming 2 each elementary and 4 up here, or?
So there's.
Well, I guess they can be shifted, correct?
They can, but their initial assignment, there will be 3 at Rice, 2 at Fairview, and 3 at secondary. Because there's 2 that were already approved, so that's not why they're on there. So 3 Rice, 2 Fairview, 3 secondary.
Okay. And based on need, I would say so. Thank you.
Any other questions from the board? Questions from the public? Seeing none, I'll make a motion to move items 1 through 5 to the agenda as so moved.
Second.
All in favor?
Aye.
Open discussions for HR. Seeing none, adjourned.
Thank you. Physical plans, Mr. Boone.
I'm present. So I'll make a motion to approve the minutes of the June 15th physical plan committee meeting. I so move.
Second.
All in favor?
Aye.
Aye. We'll be seeking approval to move the items number 1 and 2 to next week's agenda. Any questions or comments from the board? Or the public? If none, I'll make the motion to move items 1 and 2 to next week's agenda.
Second.
All in favor?
Aye.
Open discussion. Where are we on the face of the auditorium exterior? Not auditorium, gymnasium exterior.
That will be on the agenda. I have some information I'm going to send to the committee, and you'll have another item on the agenda to approve that.
Okay, thank you.
I would like to share with, and I'll have Mr. Mangini chime in too, because he was an avid person for this. I want to thank Vito's Lawn Care and Twisted Root. They're working with Kelly, Mr. Mangini, to give a fresh look at Rice Elementary and Fairview Elementary. It's a sponsorship. They are providing some shrubs, some flowers, just to freshen up right now for us at no cost to the district. And is there anything that you want to add to that? But we're very thankful for you and PTA and Twisted Root and Vito's Lawn Care for this. So.
Right. Yeah, and I think you said everything perfectly as is. One of the things that you know, people first notice when they enter our campuses is the look of the building. So as Mrs. Malazzo has said, Vito's and Twisted Root's reached out, kind of a collaboration between the PTA and them to kind of redecorate in front of the signs of the schools and the suit planters as you walk in. And not only are they going to do that before the start of the school year, but they're also going to come back and maintenance it after winter and the spring. So thank you to them for that.
And I want to thank our support staff. They are open to the idea and okay with us doing this as well. So thank you to them for allowing us to accept this donation and sponsorship.
Any other discussion? Oh, yeah.
Is there any type of update on the sewer issue?
Yeah, if you look out the back window, there's an excavator out there. Not here, back window out there. They brought it in, they delivered the tank. If you go behind the football field and look up the back steps, you'll see the tank. The holding tank came in Monday morning. They delivered the excavator today. They brought it up through the step area, they built a ramp, brought it up. Excavation starts tomorrow.
Everything you anticipate, everything be functional for the start of the school year?
Yes, they're under a liquidated damage provision in the contract for start of the school
year. 11. Any other discussion? If not, we will adjourn physical plant meeting.
Policy Committee, Mrs. Campbell.
Thank you. Myself, Ms. McCurdy, and Mr. Boone are present. I make a motion to approve the minutes of the June 15th, 2023 Policy Committee. I so move.
Second.
All in favor?
Aye.
Aye.
I am looking for approval to move items under 1, A through D, third reading and adopt, and E, second reading. To the August 17th meeting. I know we've discussed these previous, they've all come up previously since we're doing a second reading and a third reading. Does anyone have any questions on the board? In the public on these items? No? Okay. Seeing no questions, I make a motion to move these items under number 1 to the August 17th meeting.
Second.
All in favor?
Aye.
Aye. Any open discussions from the board or public under policy? No? All right, seeing none, I look to adjourn.
Thank you. Technology Committee, Mrs. McCurdy.
Thank you. Ms. Campbell and I are both present. I am seeking approval of the minutes of June 15th, 2023, Technology Committee meeting. I so move.
Second.
Thank you. All in favor?
Aye.
Any opposed? No, sorry. Approval of the following items, 1 and 2. Consideration and approval of Chromebookparts.com purchasing Chromebooks for $85,334 And consideration approval of following items to be recycled, disposed of. There's a list, but what are those items?
It was broken computers, broken Promethean boards, anything that, right?
Yeah, I have a list if you need a list. Promethean boards, carts, hard drives, computers, battery backups, projectors, monitors.
Okay, so we're gonna make a lot of space.
Yes.
That sounds good, I like that. Hopefully more of that can be recycled and disposed of. Are there any questions?
I had a question, because I know when we were talking about going to Chromebookparts.com, I know the one question was the licensing term. Was that looked into, or like, are we good, or?
We're good.
Okay.
I asked him that question.
Okay.
He actually, he's unfortunately not here today, but he wanted me to share that this, before the purchases, three bids were solicited. It was through PEPM. And he said they came in and immaculate, the boxes and
okay.
individual things. So it definitely was a good
And then we still get that 5-year.
Yep.
We're going, okay.
Yep.
Any other questions? Seeing none, I make a motion to move items 1 and 2 to the agenda next week. I so move.
Second.
All in favor?
Aye.
Thank you. Open discussions. Do we have any questions?
Yeah, I have one item of good news. The sheriff thought Amy was going to be here. He wanted to.
No, good.
Okay. I didn't know you had it.
Yeah, good news.
This happened before I was here, but apparently Damien had applied for reimbursement for costs the district had already incurred towards the end of COVID. If you recall, when the federal COVID money was allocated, and people applied, there was money left over, and they gave people a chance to apply again. So Damien applied for technology-related reimbursement, and we finally got the answer, and the answer was yes. Just over $100,000 we're going to be getting from that, and that will go right into the general fund. I did look into that. What was purchased wasn't purchased out of capital. It was purchased out of the regular budget, so it'll go right into the general fund. So that was good news. So good job, Damien.
Yeah.
No, you're not here.
Thank you, Mr. Blanchard.
Sorry.
No, that was good news.
Anything else? Seeing none, I move to adjourn.
Thank you. Transportation, Mr. Boone.
We'll call the Transportation Committee to order. Mrs. Bibla and I are present. I'll make a motion to approve the minutes of the June 15th, 2023 Transportation Committee meeting. I so move.
Second.
All in favor?
Aye.
Aye. We'll be seeking a motion to approve moving item 1 to next week's agenda. We do have enough drivers to man all the buses, correct?
Yes, so as we continue our good news, we are set to go. We actually have 2 bus spare drivers that are mechanics and 1 van spare driver. So we are ready to go.
Good.
Clearances are in, everything's good.
Any questions or comments from the board? Or the public? If not, I'll make a motion to approve moving item 1 to next week's agenda. I so move.
Second.
All in favor?
Aye.
Aye. Some discussion, communication on transportation routes.
Yeah, Mr. Cavanaugh sent out a communication earlier this week to the community and families to let them know that transportation routes should be available by the end of this week. So I know tomorrow is the end of the week, so our goal is to at least get a preliminary transportation route uploaded to our district website, and then future communication will, but there'll be a Blackboard message or an alert to let you guys know to go on to our website to find those transportation routes in advance, and then just more communication will come with more details. So at least by tomorrow, you'll be able to see the transportation routes as a general.
And thanks, John, for putting that out on the Blackboard. I think that's a great way that all the parents saw. I know a lot of people like putting that out, the message, and then saying it'll be listed. Like, I know a lot of people appreciated that, like, other than wondering when or, yeah. So that, I appreciate it too as a parent.
And I'm going to put some information out just to remind that bus patrol that we have. I think it's important as we start the school year, just communication about the stop arms, when to stop, and just reiterate to, you know, as these buses and safety for our students and our drivers. So anticipate some more information on social media or through our district website about bus control.
Any other discussion on transportation? Not we'll adjourn the Transportation Committee meeting.
Thank you. And that concludes today's meeting. Thank you.
Thank you.
No. Oh, because I said,